call it Viagra. So why we choose this name? Because it is a very, rarely used English word. So I think there are no conflict with other project names. And to start, let's talk about my our understanding of open source hardware. So everyone is know open source software very well. And a full name that should be free and open source, not just open source. And one very well-known event is that the GNU project started by Richard Stallman in 1983. And of course, at that time, people do not know about what is open source hardware. So some people think that the hardware is cheap enough, you can buy it everywhere. It's open, some kind of open source, free and open source hardware. But nowadays, we see more and more open source hardware, and we adopt the idea from open source software and then build hardware. So nowadays, people know about what exactly is open source hardware. So it's the hardware design, it's the design that can be freely obtainable in the public domain. So it's a hardware design. So let me show a few well-known projects. So what is a processor? A RISC-V processor. So it's a open source hardware. So you can download the specification of the instruction set, and you can also download the microarchitecture design. So if you have money to pick up, you can send it to the foundries, to their chips. So the design is freely available. So it's open source hardware. And the Juno and RISC-V. So you should be very familiar with these two projects. So you can get the specification of the PCB board. You know how to buy the components, and you can send the design to Hua Qianbei, and they can make one for you. So the design is freely available. So it's also an open source hardware. And there's also a project for the server for data centers. So Open Compute is a project started by Facebook, and they released the specification of an electrical design and also the mechanical design. So if you find some manufacturer that can build a server, so you can send the design to them and get a server according to their specification. So these are all examples of open source hardware. And in our project, we focus on open source processor. The processor is part of hardware, so it's not a PCB board, but it's only the chip. And according to our definition, the design of the chip is the open source hardware. So it includes three parts: the instruction set, the microarchitecture, and the tool chain. So instruction set and microarchitecture can depend about kind of hardware, and we also need the software to make it runnable. So we need a compiler to make it executable. So let's see review the examples in the general purpose computing. So RISC-V that I just mentioned. So RISC-V have an instruction set as an ISA, and it has also released some demo implementation. So for example, the rocket chip project. So you can download the source code and you can compile to get the verilog, to get the hardware and description language that you can write a chip later. And also we also released the RISC-V GCC. So you can compile from a C language to the binary program that can execute on your RISC-V processor. So it consists of three parts. And in our project, we are interested in a specialized processor. So we also propose an instruction set, and we implement the microarchitecture, and we also implement a compiler backend. So these are our project. And to make the open source processor system complete, in fact, we also need the analog IP. So for example, the DDR IP, the Wi-Fi or USB IP. So that should also be available. But currently, we only have the open source protocol that are implementing digital circuit. And I don't know how to make the analog part open source. So if you have an idea, you are very welcome to communicate. And also, we mentioned the software, the compiler, that are part of the open source hardware. But think about that, after you get the Verilog, after you get the hardware distribution language, you still need the EDA software, the design automation software, to get a layout, to get a layout from the very long. But currently, the EDA tools are also very expensive. So most of them are commercial. And although there are some open source tools, but it's not complete yet. So there's a project in the US called Open Road. So they try to get a complete flow. And we also have a future plan to get a similar project to get a complete EDA flow. So the green one, green slide, so you should know there are some a few associations based in China, work on green slide. And in our project, Rara, so we focus on the specialized processor. So it includes three parts, the compiler backend, the instruction set architecture, and the micro architecture. And we would like it to adapt for the AI applications. And then later on, we hope you can drive the development of the RISC-V ecosystem to be part of the specialized co-processor. And also we would like it to drive the rapid development methodology. So this is a general idea and the purpose of our project. So let's see briefly what our project includes. So it includes a compiler backend. So we start from some neural network format, for example, TensorFlow or PyTorch framework. And then currently we have a lot of compiler front ends to use. So we make use of some compiler front end to get the intermediary representation, and we start from the intermediary representation to generate the instructions for our processor. So we generate instructions and it can be executable on our microarchitecture. So for the specialized processors, especially for tensor processing, we collected a few other open source projects. So for example, the NVDLA from NVIDIA, and the Vita from University of Washington, and also the Dyna from Boston University. So they are all examples of open source tensor processors. So you may also try to run it on your own. But our project start in a different way. So I will explain a little bit. So let's review two example projects. So on the left hand side is the NVDLA. So in NVDLA, people start from the software stack. So because of NVIDIA, they have a lot of software engineers to work on the cuDNN. Or the optimizations. So first they have the software stack, and later on they develop a chip for autonomous driving, and they release the source code for the accelerator on their chip. So that's NVDLA. So they start from the software first, and later they release the open source processor. And Vita is another example on the right hand side. So it's originating from University of Washington. So it also starts from the compiler first, and then the processor only uses an example to demonstrate how to use the compiler. So our project is different from these two. So we start from the processor, the microarchitecture design at the beginning, and our goal, so we mentioned, have two parts. One is to drive the ecosystem of co-processor in the RISC-V ecosystem, and to the downstream in the flow, we also would like to drive the open source EDA tools. So we would like to have one open source processor. It's not only can be used in the as a co-processor, it also will drive our design methodology. So we hope to develop more design automation tools around this project. So that's the Rara project. So as I mentioned, it includes three parts, the microarchitecture instruction set and the compiler backend. So you can see we only use 5,000 lines of code, so we use the same programming language as RISC-V. We use Chisel to implement the microarchitecture, so we only use a few lines of code to get a very basic version. And we also implement a shell for the Silex FPGA acceleration card. And it will be easy to port the design for the embedded FPGA boards. So you can run either on the FPGA server or also on the embedded FPGA card. So before we start the project, we also think about this question. So what's the motivation of our project, especially when you can buy AI chips in the market? So for example, you can buy the chips from Huawei. They build a very powerful AI processors. So why we build another open source ones? So we have a different purposes. One is education, of course. We in universities, we can educate students use this framework. So students can easily implement new technology. They can replicate some ideas in existing applications, or they can try their own. So my two students work on these projects, so they know little about like hardware development and also the deep learning acceleration. But after this project, they are kind of experts. So in the afternoon, you can talk to them in our workshop. So education is a very important purpose. And also new scenarios. So we find that in the IoT domain, there are many fragmented application demands. So we find that the commercial AI chips may not be motivated enough to serve all the small markets. So open source ones will be the, we have an opportunity to serve these purpose. And also new algorithms. So currently, when you already build your AI chips, so it's fixed, it's very difficult to add more functionality. So when you have the open source ones, you can adapt to the algorithm in a shorter turnaround time, right? So you have all the source code, you don't need to communicate with the commercial AI chips. You can just try to include more features to see whether it satisfies your demand. And these are all the motivations, and we also hope to use this open source processor to drive our design methodology. So we are developing an agile development flow based on Raven. And here is the flow, how we design, test, deploy, and estimate the chip. There are multiple stages. So at the beginning, the chip design stage. Chip design stage, we use the Chisel language. So you can only leave your laptop or workstation to develop your processor. And then the second stage is the FPGA prototyping or deployment stage. So you can buy an FPGA embedded board, use only a few hundreds of IMB. That should be affordable by most developers. Or you can rent an FPGA server on Huawei Cloud or Ali Cloud. So you can either prototype your chip use FPGA infrastructure, or you can even use FPGA as an intermediate product, because FPGA is at least it's faster than your ARM processor or your RISC-V processor. So you can also use FPGA as an intermediate product. And then after that, when you find that your market is big enough, or there's some benefits, for example, for the performance or the power, then you can go to the estimation stage, ASIC estimation. So you can estimate the power performance area and the cost, use this four stage. So the stages with a right mark is a mark that means that you can perform all this development use your own laptop or something easily available. So that helps the developer a lot. So we already figure out how to do this with only your laptop or cloud server. But at the end, if you would like to tape out, it's out of the open source domain, because you have to pay the money for EDA tools, pay for the foundry, and pay for the packaging and testing. So it's no longer in the open source hardware domain. But at the first three stages, you can all develop on your own. And then at the end, so you may decide whether you should take out a chip or not. And in the second stage, when we deploy the our processor in the FPGA class, this is a illustrated example. So you prepare the data, and you compile the RAM program on the CPU, and then FPGAs nowadays have very useful infrastructure. You can transfer the data and the instruction in the program to the FPGA card, to this memory, and then you can start our processor. So the processor read the data and read the program in the memory, and then after it compute, it stores the data on the memory. And then CPU can move the memory back to the CPU memory. So that's the deployment or the prototype flow. So you can use this way to test your processor. So it can run, for example, like 200 megahertz. So that's fast enough to do the prototype. So here is a short introduction to our instruction set architecture. And we do a survey on the public available instruction set architecture description. So for example, the ISA for Hanuji, for Capcom, and also the ISA for TPU, Google TPU. So we study a lot of the instruction architecture. And then we propose our own. So our instruction set architecture consists of two parts. One is the macro instruction. So it's like a CISC instruction, a complex instruction set architecture. So we can move data from memory to the on-chip memory, or move data from on-chip memory back to the off-chip memory. And then we can also execute, do some computation inside the chip. And for the computation, we can describe a more complicated behavior. So we also define a level of micro operation. So each complicated instruction can read a few micro operations to know what it should do in one instruction. So the micro operation is like the reduced instruction set architecture. And then in our processor design, if we would like to support one new instruction, how to do it? So we should modify the micro architecture and also the compiler backend. So for the micro architecture, it's easy to support one new instruction. So we just add one more macro to handle that instruction. But of course, when you add more and more instruction, then you may use up your hardware resources. Then you can think about how to do the optimization. So currently we do this manually, and later on in the next 1 or 2 years, we hope to develop some design tools, some automated tools to do the optimization automatically. So for example, we have one method to support instruction ABC, to support a few instructions that rely on a more final grade modules, and also we have another macro Y that relies on the final grade modules BCD. So we may merge these two macro to be a single bigger macro that support both instructions. So that's a basic idea. To add the support for a new instruction, we just add one more macro. And then later on, you can think about how to merge these macros to save hardware. And we also need to do more on the compiler backend. So my student will show how to implement to support one new instruction and how to modify the compiler backend in the afternoon's workshop. And if you know about Vita, you know about Vita that I mentioned, started at University of Washington. You may find that our design at this stage has many things in common with Vita. So because we use the same compiler front end, we use the same compiler TVM. So we lock saying that it's fake at this stage. But our compiler supports both the meta injunction and the new customized injunctions. And the difference is that meta at the beginning is designed for the tensor processor. And our processor is one example that we would like to study how we should develop a processor for a specific domain. And the ultimate goal of our processor is to develop a design methodology, not just a single processor. A design methodology when we have a new domain, how we can develop a new processor. And then and the Vita, the main purpose is to serve as a co-processor, and our rebel processor can be a standalone processor. So that's the difference. And this is how we do the compiler backend. So I will skip the details. So currently we implement all these modules in the Chisel language. So Chisel language uses Scala as a mother language, and it's a domain-specific language built on top of Scala. And then at the end, we release the documents. So currently, we already released a source code, but it's not helpful for developers. So we hope to get the document as soon as possible. And currently, we are implementing this version, a very simplified baseline version. So we can compute the vector processing, the matrix processing, convolution, pooling. And then later on, we will extend it to support like a few irregular small tasks, and also extend it to be this architecture. Support the high throughput big tasks. And we already found some collaborators to work on the this version. And then in the document, we will show in the document that we are working on, we will show how to include a new feature and how to modify the MIMO architecture and how to modify the compiler backend. And in the future, so we can be part of the RISC-V ecosystem to be a co-processor. And later on, we hope this design methodology can drive to develop a more specialized co-processor. So there's some details. We are working on this design flow. So we start from the computation for specific domain. So we build the macro library. We build a macro library. The library can be synthesized to become a micro architecture. And then the computation can be described as a compute graph. And then we can choose how to implement the compute graph using the micro architecture. Okay. And we will do the placement and routing. So that's what I mean at the beginning. We would like to use the rebel processor to drive the development of design automation tools. Okay, so currently the core members only have a three person, one faculty and two students. So we start this project at the end of last year, and we develop in a satisfactory speed. And currently you can download the code in the OpenAI website, openai.org.cn, and the project number is 99. So I like this number. And in the afternoon. There will be a workshop. You are also to show how you can develop support a new instruction by using.